when I think about facing history, I think about chasing the flame. And there are a lot of different ways one can think about chasing the flame. One, of course, just people in pursuit of ideals who think about causes bigger than themselves. Second, if you think about the flame, what a flame really is, a proximity to risk. Facing history is all about risk, ultimately, in a sense, getting students and teachers to take risks in the classroom in order to create a different kind of engagement or inculcate a different spirit of engagement in the world. And then also the word chasing, which is really about never quite reaching that destination, but remaining resilient nonetheless, sort of getting back up again and again when you don't get to necessarily see the world that you dream of playing a small role in creating. The way that facing history has influenced the students that I've encountered across the country is really kind of monumental. And I think the way I would characterize facing history's impact on the way that history is taught, and I defer to you in the discussion period to tell me if this is wrong or right, but just to, again, this is anecdotal encounters with classrooms from Houston to San Francisco to Chicago and so forth. It seems to me there are three big shifts that facing history has helped generate in its classrooms with its through its teachers, through people like you. First, history is not static in facing history classrooms. It is active. It is always in flux. There's a sense that nothing is inevitable. Second, when I took history classes, it was very statist. You know, you had a sense of countries on the map and decisions that came out of those countries, and the countries would be colored different colors depending on what part of what empire they were, who they were at war with one another. But with the exception of statesmen who ran those countries, who were in a sense just anthropomorphic versions of the countries, you didn't have a sense of individuals driving history. And I think this disaggregation of the state, the disaggregation of countries into the individuals that comprise them is a radical and essential shift. And then thirdly, and I've spoken a lot about this in the past, when you think about history of mass suffering and mass atrocity, to shift the history from a debate about perpetrators and victims, categories into which most of us hope and assume we won't fall. Certainly most people assume they won't become perpetrators and they hope they won't become victims. But where the identification can be blunted by generations and by you know, just very, very different life circumstances, to shift that history from perpetrators and victims to this continuum that all of us fall on, from bystanders to upstanders. And that's a monumental shift. And it gets people, young people and teachers, all of us, really engaging in a space, again, we're much more likely to have to confront. For young people, it's about talking to the unlike-minded more broadly. I mean, our society is getting so much more polarized. It's so much easier for all of us just to select news around our pre-existing biases, whether it's Dick Cheney insisting that, you know, every hotel room he goes to has all the televisions on when he arrives and Fox News on every television, and there'll be no remote controls. He'll hit power when he's ready to go to bed. Or those of us who might be, you know, have different politics or whatever, but, you know, selecting around our biases, avoiding Fox News like the plague. My new husband, Cass Sunstein, has popularized the term the daily me. You know, I get to read every day. It's so great. I get to read the daily Samantha just to select around my preferences. And I never, as a young person, would have put in my Google search engine concentration camps. I would never even be, I certainly wouldn't be up here, had I not stumbled into this serendipitous and inconvenient knowledge that there were terrible things going on in Bosnia back in the early 1990s. How do we get our young people to be continuing to be exposed to unlike-minded people, perspectives, sources of information? It's a real challenge, and it's just going to get harder and harder to manage.